Tonight, a Russian missile strikes a packed Ukrainian shopping mall.
I just am out of words.
Western leaders up their troop readiness. Also tonight, a fatal train derailment in Missouri.
We're okay. We're okay.
Late airline baggage piles up, so does passenger frustration.
They need to fix this. People can't go through this.
And Ioana Romiliotis' brother needed a kidney, so she donated hers.
I have to consider myself very, very lucky that I had you.
A family story, a universal message. This is The National. Good evening, I'm Andrew Chang. Adrian is away. In Ukraine, crews are searching for survivors and bodies in the smoldering ruins of a shopping mall. It was the target of a Russian missile strike. Ukraine's president called it one of the most brazen terrorist attacks in Europe's history. At least 16 are dead there, and it wasn't the only civilian target. Chris Brown is in Kharkiv and has the details.
An inferno of flames and towering black smoke is all that's left of another civilian target hit by Russian missiles, a shopping mall in central Ukraine. The country's presidential administration says more than 1,000 people were inside. Is anybody alive? Is anybody alive? Someone calls out.
I was not far away from the place where it happened.
Vadim Yudenko was nearby and saw it all.
The center was just destroyed. I'm out of words. I did not expect that something like this could happen in my town.
Amid the chaos of the rescue effort, it may be a while before the full extent of the casualties are known.
At risk.
A UN spokesman condemned the attack, but notably not the attacker, Russia.
We're obviously concerned about the intensifying fighting that we have seen.
Indeed, here in Kharkiv, there have been so many missile hits in recent days that the shocks of incoming artillery, rockets, and missiles have been nonstop. A Russian Iskander ballistic missile did this, said a local resident. There used to be a garage here. I have no idea what the Russians expected to destroy. Russia's Ministry of Defense admits to hitting only military targets, saying its artillery has been destroying Ukrainian nationalists, as it calls them, as it seeks to consolidate control of the city of Severodonetsk and continues to move towards the next target, the city of Lysychansk.
Hello, Madam President. Nice to meet you.
In the middle of all the missiles, foreign leaders are still visiting Kyiv. Today it was a visit from Ukraine's neighbor, the president of Moldova.
Moldova fully supports the independence, sovereignty and territorial integrity of Ukraine within its internationally recognized borders.
Due to the Russian threat from the skies, we're in an air raid shelter now. Analysts, including advisors to Ukraine's government, say all these missile strikes may be the Kremlin's way of trying to put pressure on G7 nations to stop helping Ukraine or to get the West to push Ukraine into trading land for peace, something very few Ukrainians will accept. Chris Brown, CBC News, Kharkiv.
Canada's foreign minister has denounced the strike on that shopping mall. In a statement, Mélanie Joly said Russia's brutal attack is an abhorrent crime and that it and other atrocities cannot and will not go unpunished. The question of how to hold Russia to account is top of mind for leaders at the G7. David Cochrane has the promises from the summit in Germany and also the massive military shift coming from NATO.
The future of Ukraine has been on their agenda. Now the country's president was on their screen, Volodymyr Zelensky outlining his country's needs. He pressed for continued military support, help freeing Ukrainian grain from Russian blockades, and new sanctions to further punish and pressure the Kremlin. The summit's host made it clear leaders would do more.
We will help the Ukraine as much as is possible, but that we also avoid that there will be a big conflict between Russia and NATO.
The G7 issued a statement saying it would support Ukraine for as long as it takes. The U.S. announced billions in financial aid, tougher sanctions, and confirmed it would buy an advanced anti-aircraft system for Ukraine. Canada imposed sanctions on Russia's defense sector and blocked the export of technology Russia's military might use. As Zelensky laid out what he needs to fight Russia, NATO spelled out what it will do to contain Russia.
We will enhance our battle groups in the eastern part of the alliance up to brigade levels. We will transform the NATO response force and increase the number of our high readiness forces to well over 300,000.
Canada leads the NATO battle group in Latvia, where about 700 Canadian troops are stationed. Total NATO troops could double or even triple in size there as part of this overall plan, which Stoltenberg calls the biggest overhaul of NATO's defense and deterrence since the Cold War.
I expect it will make clear that allies consider Russia as the most significant and direct threat to our security.
This means Canada will have to increase its troop contributions to NATO. The precise details aren't known, but are expected to be made clear at the NATO summit in Spain on Wednesday. David Cochran, CBC News, Garmisch-Partenkirchen, Germany.
Well, according to credit rating agency Moody's, Russia has defaulted on its international bonds for the first time in more than a century. But the Kremlin says the default has been manufactured by the West. Up until now, Russia has been paying on time and reportedly has the funds. It says tightened U.S. sanctions effectively block it from making payments. Well, there was chaos in Missouri today after a train carrying hundreds of people hit a dump truck and derailed. At least three people were killed. Cameron McIntosh shows us the dramatic scene as passengers scrambled to get out.
This is what we're seeing so far. You see ladders up against the car.
Knocked clear from the track, seven rail cars lay strewn on their side as passengers tried to climb out. Rescue workers using ladders, helping to pull people out through the windows.
You can see they are set up here treating those who are injured. Ooh, that looks like what may be left of the dump truck.
Amtrak says the train bound from L.A. to Chicago struck a dump truck at an uncontrolled rail crossing near Mendon, Missouri. The driver of the truck is among the dead. At least 40 others were taken to hospital, some airlifted from the crash site. Fortunately, most of the 243 passengers and 12 crew were only shaken up after being thrown from their seats.
And we started evacuating people out of the car as quick as possible.
This passenger is a teacher who was traveling with a group of students. None were injured.
I don't have a scratch on me. You know, people around me have bumps, bruises, they've got bruised ribs.
Damn, we hit a truck. Someone was crossing tracks.
Locals say they've long complained to the railway that brush blocks the view here.
Amtrak comes through here at anywhere from 75 to 100 miles per hour. So it doesn't give you much time to cross.
It's an uncontrolled crossbuck intersection on a gravel road. So no lights, no electronic control devices, things such as that.
An investigation is underway.
I'm very thankful that everyone in my group, they're going home tonight.
Leaving with a feeling this could have been so much worse. Cameron McIntosh, CBC News, Winnipeg.
We are following some horrific breaking news from Texas tonight. The bodies of 46 adults have been found in and around a tractor trailer just outside of San Antonio. 16 others, including four children, were alive and taken to hospital. Officials described them as hot to the touch and suffering from exhaustion. They're believed to be migrants. Local police say three people are in custody in what is now a federal investigation. Constitutional challenges, protests, fear, and confusion. They're all playing out in the U.S. as states and advocates battle over abortion rights and access. Susan Ormiston has those details.
Come on and join the fight!
Abortion is a human right!
The fight is heating up, with legal challenges in at least six states already, and American women searching for up-to-date information, changing by the day.
It is complete chaos across the country. Abortion care providers have no idea what is or is not illegal.
In Louisiana, the Hope Medical Clinic sued the state against three so-called trigger laws which kicked in Friday, banning abortion.
There was mass confusion with respect to abortion care providers about what conduct was legal and what conduct was now criminalized.
A judge today blocked Louisiana's ban temporarily, so abortion services resumed. For people like this woman who spoke to CBC in May.
I would love to keep the baby, but I'm still in school and I'm living with my mom, so it just is not the right time.
But the U.S. is now a patchwork. Banned, pending bans, uncertain, legal, and with anti-abortion activists trying to expand restrictions.
We have just put out a huge fire, the taking of 4,000 unborn American lives every day.
I think those who oppose abortion think that they've won the day and that magically people are going to continue pregnancies, and that's not how it's going to go.
The director of the Red River Clinic in North Dakota, facing closure next month, plans to move it 15 minutes across state lines to Minnesota. A GoFundMe campaign for the move has already netted more than $700,000 in 4 days.
The outpouring of support is, you know, beyond, I literally can't believe it. I don't feel like it's real. I think that people feel powerless right now, and that this is one way that they can give.
Pro-choice, that's the lie!
Babies never choose to die!
But no one doubts a fierce battle ahead.
Okay, so Susan, President Biden says abortion will be on the ballot. What would that look like?
No doubt it will be an issue in the midterm elections. And today, California took a first step, saying that it will make an amendment to the state constitution to guarantee reproductive freedoms and send that to the voters for approval come November. So that's a first step. We'll see what other states do.
Okay, Susan in Washington, thank you. The U.S. House Committee looking into the January 6th attack on the Capitol will hold a surprise hearing tomorrow. The panel says it will present newly obtained evidence and hear witness testimony, but wouldn't reveal many more details than that. The committee wasn't expected to hold additional hearings until next month. With Canada Day approaching, Ottawa is preparing for a surge of people ready to celebrate. But with the winter's convoy protests fresh in mind, police say they're ready for those as well. Rafa Bujikanyan has that story.
A Canada Day tradition in the city that hosted a unique gathering in the winter.
Freedom! Freedom! Freedom!
Some participants say they're returning.
I think it's just a bunch of nonsense. I don't know why they keep coming back.
Police say they're ready.
We expect there to be demonstrations. This is a right of all Canadians and it will be protected. We will not, however, accept unlawful behavior.
The city says it'll have backup from the Mounties and Ontario Provincial Police. Vehicle traffic will be banned in front of much of Parliament, but not in the popular Byward Market.
It's like a really busy day where a lot of people come in downtown. So I guess you'll just have to see if like it is enough.
In February, an incident prompted this business owner to put special limits on her store.
A gentleman wandered back and forth in front of the store, pushed his way in front of, through the store without a mask. I told him to put on a mask. He said he was exempt. I said, put it on or leave. He came back the following day with a threatening letter.
One organizer says he's not out to cause trouble.
We are going to be peaceful. We are going to be lawful. And if they want to try and crack down us for peacefully protesting on Parliament Hill, then there's nothing we can do.
But his group is just one of many, and it will be sticking around over multiple weekends. Police are short on details, but say they're ready for the long haul.
As long as there are public safety concerns, we will have operations in effect to manage those, regardless of how long they last.
Because of renovations on Parliament Hill, the festivities this year will take place nearly 2 kilometers away. No matter, say some protesters, they'll hold a dance party here. Rafi Bujikanyan, CBC News, Ottawa.
Well, one of this winter's Ottawa protest organizers has been arrested in Alberta. Tamara Lich's lawyer tweeted out that her client's arrest appears to be related to bail conditions. It's not yet clear which one she's accused of breaching. Well, the Pope's visit to Canada is less than a month away. During a 5-day tour, he's expected to apologize for the church's role in residential schools. Julia Wong shows us planning is now well underway in one of the first communities that he'll visit.
I welcome him. I welcome that opportunity.
Residential school survivor John Cryer has been waiting for this visit for a long time.
I welcome that, for all of us in Canada to be able to, really define what reconciliation is.
He's one of about 15,000 people expected to be in Maskwacis, Alberta, to see Pope Francis on his first full day in the country.
He wants to spend time with survivors. So we welcome from coast to coast, any of those that can make it.
Both Cryer and Wilton Littlechild attended the Ermitskin Residential School there. It was one of the largest in Canada.
This is where the former Ermitskin Residential School once stood. The Pope will be stopping here during his visit, as well as a cemetery nearby.
It's during this leg of his trip that Francis is expected to apologize for the church's role in residential schools.
The three words they wanted to hear was, "I am sorry."
It's a big moment for survivors and for the community that will host it.
We're logistically looking at issues of maybe big screen TVs, right? Because we want to try and figure out how do we get him out to the masses.
The Pope is only expected to stay for about an hour, limited because of his health.
That's not very long. And to come there and sit with people, I know many people are going to be disappointed.
I don't think everybody's going to be able to shake his hand. However, just being here in an indigenous community, you know, speaks loud.
There's also planning for what comes after the apology, which could take an emotional toll.
He will apologize, then he leaves, then we are left holding the bag. Who's going to look after these individuals? We need to prepare ourselves.
A short trip, but one expected to have long-lasting impacts. Julia Wong, CBC News, Maskwacis, Alberta.
Tonight, a major development following an undercover CBC Marketplace investigation. Police have arrested two Toronto men, key figures in a group of national moving companies, accused of deceptive pricing. As David Common shows us, our cameras were there just moments after officers moved in.
Rarely do customer complaints lead to a large-scale police raid like this, laying fraud and multiple other charges against Jamal Ozturk and Doan Celik, who together ran a supposedly low-cost national moving company that goes by multiple names, but police allege had one thing in common. Customers were offered a seemingly low-cost contract. But once the items were loaded onto a truck, the men would contact the customers, making a demand for more money, often in the thousands of dollars, and refuse delivery until payment was made. The police action comes on the heels of a hidden camera investigation by CBC Marketplace into the same movers, where similar behavior was documented.
They charged this young woman a lot more than they said they were going to charge her. A lot more.
Yet another customer, Darlene Sherrington, was told her move would cost a little more than $1,000. But after the movers pick up her stuff...
On the highway, I get a call from the girl at the main office. She says, your bill now is $3,029.
More than double what she's expecting.
They shouldn't be doing this to old people or even young people.
None of the charges against the two men have been proven in court, but Toronto police are now reuniting customers with belongings, including family heirlooms and the ashes of deceased loved ones. They're also seizing moving trucks and other assets.
It's tricky at the moment because we're still trying to figure out what's there and what needs to go to PEI and what needs to go to London and what needs to go other places in the Maritimes.
Before his arrest, Doan Celik told Marketplace his companies value customers and that he'd review what happened. The criminal charges show many others will be reviewing too. David Common, CBC News, Toronto.
Well, it's not just long lines and canceled flights causing headaches at Canadian airports.
No one knows where to go or what to do. It's chaos.
What you need to know before you pack for that summer flight.
It's been a vacation from hell.
Plus, Nazem Kadri's Stanley Cup triumph hits home back in Canada.
It would make me think I can do it too one day.
And when her brother needed a kidney, Ioana Romiliotis gave him one of hers.
It's only now, 2 months after the surgery, that I'm actually able to talk about it and to actually think about it.
Now she's sharing her family's story about the power of donating an organ.
I have to consider myself very, very lucky that I had you. You know, you feel that. Why should I be so lucky?
We're back in two. Welcome back. Families of 21 teenagers who died at a tavern in South Africa over the weekend are still looking for answers as to what exactly happened.
We are so heartbroken, guys. We lost one of our family members, a child who was doing grade 12 this year.
Local authorities say the teens were probably accidentally poisoned by something they ate, drank, or smoked at the tavern. A toxicology report is expected. Basketball star Brittany Griner's trial is set to begin Friday in Moscow. The 31-year-old athlete is facing charges of illegal cannabis possession. She was arrested at the airport with vape cartridges just days before Russia invaded Ukraine. If convicted, Griner could face a sentence of up to 10 years in prison. More than 700 flights were canceled in the United States today, disrupting travel for thousands of passengers. It comes after a chaotic weekend with more than 1,500 cancellations. Airlines blame it on bad weather and a staffing crunch. Well, as airlines here and the Canadian government race to address long lines and delays at airports, some travelers are pointing out another major issue: missing luggage. As Sophia Harris shows, it sometimes doesn't show up for the entire trip.
It's chaos.
Harrison Burton shot this video on Friday after landing in Montreal on an Air Canada flight.
No customer service staff.
Burton couldn't find his luggage here, and 3 days later, it still hadn't arrived.
They need to fix this, otherwise they're going to shut it down because people can't go through this kind of misery.
The chaos at some Canadian airports continues due to a surge in demand at a time of staffing shortages. There are complaints of long lineups, delayed and cancelled flights, and as an offshoot,
this is the amount of bags.
Missing baggage that's sometimes hard to find.
It's been emotionally draining, emotionally, mentally draining.
Sarah Fermel and her family flew with Air Canada from Toronto to Edinburgh for a wedding. Their luggage never arrived, so they had to scramble to buy necessities, including wedding attire.
It's been a vacation from hell. You know, we've stripped of everything that we had. And I don't know when we'll get it back.
So who's to blame? Ottawa says it has hired more airport staff, but last week pointed a finger at the airlines.
We want to make sure that the airlines as well do their part.
In a statement, Air Canada said most passengers fly with their luggage and that many of the reasons behind baggage delays, such as airport backlogs, are outside the airline's control.
Maybe they should have...
This business professor says all parties dropped the ball by not being better prepared.
It just seems to me it's been a lot of flying, no pun intended, flying by the seat of their pants instead of a more, shall we say, strategic approach to the reopening of the air travel sector.
On Monday, the government said it's working with major airports and airlines to resolve lingering travel issues. In the meantime, travelers still searching for their bags can at least take solace in this. Under federal rules, they can claim up to $2,300 for lost or delayed luggage. Sophia Harris, CBC News, Toronto.
Well, next, a personal story from a familiar face about how she helped save her brother's life.
I'm sharing this experience that I went through because I really hope it will help other people too.
Joanna Ramiliotis shares what it was like for her to become a living organ donor.
It's something that will change somebody's life, literally, overnight.
Also, what she and her family hope others can learn from their experience. Being a living organ donor, it's not something most people think about until they have to. Recently, our very own senior reporter, Joanna Ramiliotis, had to when her brother suddenly needed a kidney transplant. Tonight, Joanna shares her family's story of giving and receiving a life-saving organ.
Sometimes, life takes us on a trip we could never have expected.
These are your boarding pass, ready for validation. Thank you and have a pleasant trip.
That's exactly what happened to me when my brother suddenly needed a kidney transplant, and I was his best hope for one. This is my family's story of giving and receiving a life-saving organ.
So, when I was in the thick of it, the only way I could get through it was to keep looking forward to the next trip, to the next appointment, because it was so intense and it was so emotional. And it's only now, 2 months after the surgery, 2 months after I donated my left kidney, that I'm actually able to talk about it and to actually think about it. And this is so new to me because I'm used to telling other people's stories, not my own. But I'm sharing this experience that I went through because I really hope it will help other people too.
Like most people, I didn't think much about organ transplants until it hit close to home. I live in Toronto now. Montreal is where I grew up.
Surprise!
Where my brother still lives and where our story begins.
Hey, sweetie.
This is the first time I've seen him since our surgeries.
Squeezy.
Okay, come on in.
Hey, the house looks so clean. So what happens when your sister comes to town with the camera? Let me fix that for you. Oh, I never thought I'd be miking up my brother. So how are you feeling?
Pretty good. Day by day, I feel better. And so far, no adverse effects from all the medication that I'm taking, which is good.
Pretty good, eh?
And how about you? How are you feeling now?
I'm better. Almost 100%, like close to it.
Yeah.
John was diagnosed with polycystic kidney disease 7 years ago. Cysts were growing in his kidneys, impairing their function. Most cases are hereditary. My brother and sister and I had a 50% chance of getting the disease from a parent who has it. Our dad doesn't. Our mom must have. She died of an aneurysm when we were kids. Knowing what we know now, her death was likely tied to the disease.
When your kidneys suddenly started to fail, do you remember like what was going on in your mind at the time?
It was one of the worst feelings I had. I mean, I was from one day feeling fine, and a week later I just felt completely drained. I felt like a very unhealthy person that could barely walk. I stopped eating, I stopped drinking, and then that probably precipitated the whole crash.
John was put on dialysis, and just before he was, he asked if I would consider giving him a kidney. I immediately said yes.
And so I have to consider myself very, very lucky that I had you. You know, you feel that, why should I be so lucky? You know? And this is where you want to try to make other people feel lucky too. You know, you want to give them the option. Sorry. You want to make sure everybody has that chance. You know, and so I think it's important that you do this so other people become aware how being a living donor will save someone's life.
More than 4,000 Canadians are waiting for a transplant, and more than 250 die each year waiting for an organ. As my hospital visits began, the sobering truth set in. My brother faced up to a 5-year wait for a deceased donor because he could only draw from a narrow donor pool. He has type O blood. That means he can only receive an organ from a donor with the same blood type. Luckily, I am type O too.
My brother and I have the same blood type, so that was a good start, but it was just the beginning of an exhaustive assessment process that took place here at the Royal Victoria Hospital to determine whether or not we were a match, but also whether or not I was a good candidate to be a live donor. So I went through every test imaginable from head to toe. I was screened for any possible sign of infection or disease, and that's inherently stressful. And the bottom line was I healthy enough to undergo major surgery? And were my own kidneys healthy enough that I could afford to spare one?
How have you been doing? Fantastic. You look good.
Oh, thank you. It's nice seeing you wearing my old hat as a journalist.
Dr. Essen Alam is the medical director of the live donor program at the Montreal University Health Center.
The process of being assessed is so exhaustive. And why is that necessary?
So we want to make sure that the donor, yourself, that you're healthy and you can live with one kidney. And so we do an extensive medical evaluation, a surgical evaluation, as well as a psychosocial evaluation to make sure people understand what they're getting into. And once they give a kidney, they can go on with life without having to worry about their health. Come on in.
Dr. Alam is also a nephrologist specializing in polycystic kidney disease and has been my brother's doctor for years.
So, how's it feel?
It's liberating, definitely liberating. I mean,
because live donors are so thoroughly checked, he says their organs are healthy, and that means better outcomes for recipients like my brother.
I knew your brother when he was in the clinic before he developed advanced kidney disease. I then was there when he started dialysis. And to then see him get a kidney and be able to walk out of the hospital, it's really rewarding to be part of that journey.
Nice toss, man.
But the journey itself wasn't easy. For both of us, there was so much at stake. John has 3 kids. So do I. Everyone was anxious, but also reassured because every step was such a cautious one. I didn't focus on the risks that come with any surgery. Not being able to do something would have been much harder. And we were in such good hands.
Hey, Dr. Feldman. Hi, Dr. Parskevis. It's a reunion. Good to see you.
So nice to see you both.
Dr. Stephen Parskevis and Dr. Leanne Feldman were our surgeons, and they were happy to talk to us about what can seem like an overwhelming process for live donors, but is routinely a successful one.
What would you say to prospective donors to ease their anxiety about it?
I think the first thing is that it's not right for everybody, but the first step of starting the process could be right for everybody. And over the years, we've really worked on trying to improve the experience for the donors in terms of the recovery from the surgery.
Right, and you know, you talk about it being a brave decision. Why do you say that?
Well, you're the hero in this situation, Joanna, to have an operation that you don't need, that you don't benefit from, except in a psychological sense, knowing that you did something great for someone you love. That is unique in medicine. We don't have any other treatment or procedure that we do on someone who doesn't really need it.
Yeah, it makes it special for you guys too, obviously, right?
Absolutely.
What kind of impact do you hope any story, not just this one, will have on live donors and, you know, just the prospects of more transplants?
Well, I think just the more people demystify it, it's not to minimize it, it's a big deal, but that it's something that will change somebody's life, literally, overnight.
I wish my family's story ended here, but it doesn't.
The day of the surgery was surreal, I'd say.
My sister Jeannie, who lives in Ottawa, has the same disease and recently found out she will also need a transplant soon.
How did it help you? Seeing us go through it.
I think it prepped me and it made me less afraid because you had a big role in not letting us get super nervous and you were the filter for all the information. I think part of me was too scared to look up all the information about what I need to know.
So we kind of prepped you.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Jeannie's children are at risk of developing the disease later in life, so they can't be donors. Her blood type is also O. The hope is she'll find a live donor before she has to go on dialysis. She's anxious, but the success of our surgeries showed her the way forward.
I guess it gave me hope. It gave me hope and it took away a lot of the weight. Not that the weight's not there. I mean, it'll be there until I finish the process myself. But it took away a lot of the uncertainty.
The fear of the unknown.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't have another kidney to give you.
I know.
Otherwise, I'd give you another one, Jeannie. Have another.
My brother and sister are the brave ones. I was spared the disease, but I consider being able to help a privilege. This disease could affect the next generation in our family too. This story is about hope. It's for all of them and for someone else's family too.
Wow. Okay. Joanna, talk to me. I have so many questions, starting with maybe why you wanted to share your story in the way that you have.
I really just wanted to raise public awareness about the role, the critical role live donors can play. There's more than 4,000 Canadians on a wait list for a transplant. Most of them, about 80%, need a kidney. So I helped my brother, for sure. I helped him directly. But it also means that he got off the wait list for a deceased donor. Mm. And that puts one family closer to a transplant. So there's this huge shortage of organs, though, that remains. And live donors kind of fill that gap, if you will. And it's quite easy to become one. If you're in good health, anyone can donate to anyone that they want to help. And you can live a normal life with one kidney. So it's definitely worth the payoff.
And can I ask you, what would have happened if you hadn't been a perfect match with your brother?
I could have still donated a kidney on his behalf. It's called the Paired Kidney Donation Program, run by Canadian Blood Services, and it's in collaboration with the transplant centers across the country. So what would have happened was I would have given a kidney and that would have been matched to somebody that it was a match to, and a suitable living donor would have been found for my brother. Mm. So this program has helped about 900 Canadians since it started in 2009, and a single paired donation can result in 10 transplants. Wow. So it's a remarkable program, and it does offer a lot of hope.
Well, it's a great story. Thank you for telling it, Joanna.
Thank you.
And if you have questions that you'd like to ask Joanna, she'll be answering them on our Instagram account. That's @CBC The National. And once you're there, you can leave your question now in our story. Just tap our logo in the top left corner. Okay, when we come back, what could a pandemic without academic tests and exams mean for students?
We can't assess the gravity of the problem created for kids.
Why some say it's time to rethink how we assess learning in the classroom. And later, the women making history in the water on Newfoundland. For millions of students, this is the last week of school. But many teachers and parents are already focused on September and how to help kids who may have fallen behind. Testing is one way to understand the effects of lockdown learning. But some say it misses the mark. Here's Deanna Sumanak-Johnson with the learning curve.
This Toronto family is looking forward to a relaxing summer after a difficult school year for 9-year-old Sam. His grade 3 teacher noticed he was having learning challenges, a problem that would have been discovered, says his mom Simone, had a teacher been able to test what he learned earlier in the pandemic.
100% they would have. They definitely would have made grade 3 a lot smoother. I feel like we're doing a lot of catch-up this year, not just in classroom, but also at home.
That's not the only issue stemming from the lack of testing during much of the last 2 years. Many students say they feel out of practice when it comes to writing tests and exams. The pandemic also forced many provinces to cancel standardized testing, the exams that measure student performance against expectations, and that has some worried.
What we're missing when we don't have a system-wide picture of what students are learning, what they can do, what they know, is it puts us in a position where we can't assess the gravity of the problem created for kids learning by the pandemic and the policy responses to it.
But some say the pandemic has provided an opportunity to rethink standardized testing. This high school student says Ontario's recently resumed provincial assessments were unfair on students.
If there's a time to really reconsider implementing it and pushing it on students after all they've been through, this would definitely be it.
Simone Fried says tests are key to keeping tabs on student progress.
I do believe that the concept of having an assessment, concepts of having tests, still need to stand no matter what. Because that helps you understand, are we progressing to our goal? And from an education perspective, the goal is going to be going through a curriculum, attaining certain skills, and making sure that the skills have a certain competency.
Okay, so Deanna, is there a sense of what standardized testing will reveal about where students are at now?
Well, Andrew, one place that never stopped doing them throughout the pandemic is Alberta. They do these early reading and writing assessments for grades 1 through 3. And when they ran them in the last school year, they found that kids were 8 to 12 months behind where they should be in these core competencies. When they ran it again in this school year, kids were even deeper, further behind, and it affected the older grades as well. And closer to home here in the Toronto District School Board, they just ran a brief literacy assessment of, again, the earliest of grades, and they found that kids are just a little bit behind, haven't fallen behind quite as much, but there was a deep disparity between kids in low-income neighborhoods and those in the wealthier neighborhoods.
Right. Okay, Deanna, thanks very much.
Thanks for having me.
Well, Colorado Stanley Cup win is being celebrated here in Canada, especially in London, Ontario, the hometown of the Avalanche's Nazem Kadri.
It is a celebration of multiculturalism where a young Muslim kid can live the ultimate of Canadian dreams and hoist that Stanley Cup.
Next, we'll hear from his family, friends, and the next generation of hockey fans. One of the world's most prestigious tennis tournaments got underway today without several top-ranked players. Wimbledon's organizers have stuck with their decision to ban players from Russia and Belarus over the invasion of Ukraine. Among the Canadians in the mix this year, Félix Auger-Aliassime, Denis Shapovalov, and Bianca Andreescu.
Today, we are pleased to announce 6 members of the Hockey Hall of Fame's class of 2022.
And a big day today for 3 former Vancouver Canucks. Twins Henrik and Daniel Sedin and goaltender Roberto Luongo were named to the Hockey Hall of Fame and in their first year of eligibility. Also in this year's class, former Ottawa Senators captain Daniel Alfredson. Well, there is a new team at the top of the NHL. Last night, the Colorado Avalanche became Stanley Cup champions, beating the Tampa Bay Lightning. Among those celebrating today, the family of Ontario's Nazem Kadri. This was his first Stanley Cup victory, and as Stephen D'Souza reports, it's being seen as a big win for the Muslim community.
Nazem Kadri's been dreaming about this his entire life, lifting the cup. For these kids in the Toronto Muslim Ball Hockey Association, seeing it makes their own dreams that much more real.
We look at him and, you know, he's a huge inspiration for us.
I know all of us can win the Stanley Cup. We just need to try hard. It would make me think I can do it too one day.
Nazem Kadri.
When he was drafted by the Toronto Maple Leafs in 2009, Kadri knew he represented something bigger.
There's a stereotype that not many, of my community play hockey, and I think that's the wrong stereotype.
Today is a celebration of multiculturalism, where a young Muslim kid can live the ultimate of Canadian dreams, and hoist that Stanley Cup. And so it's great for the game of hockey.
Family and friends say they knew this was his destiny. Kadri's family emigrated to Canada in the 1960s. His father always dreamed of his son playing in the NHL. Last night, the Kadris embraced at the end of a long, often difficult road. Some of the adversity in his career was self-inflicted. After back-to-back playoff suspensions, the Leafs traded him and his reputation. But another form of adversity came from being a brash brown face in a predominantly white game. This season, his wife shared the hate and abuse he was receiving online.
He's a tough guy, you know, mentally and physically. He handled everything because he just, you know, been through it and seen it.
The win, a moment of joy for Muslims in London, still reeling from last year's attack.
They're so, so proud of him, and I think they're just so ecstatic and so excited to just bring it home.
Now they're looking forward to the first Stanley Cup party in a mosque, even those who may never touch the cup. Stephen D'Souza, CBC News, Toronto.
Now, on top of their win last night, the Avalanche also set a bit of a dubious new record, reportedly becoming the fastest team to damage the Stanley Cup.
Favorite moments, Chris, in 1988, yep. Wayne Gretzky. Oh, there's a little bit of a tumble.
Within minutes of winning, that stumble led to a fairly noticeable dent at the base of the trophy. But the man in charge of looking after the cup says there's no reason for concern.
But you know what? It's the third time the Avalanche have won it. I guess we have a little chat with them soon, and we'll go through the process of how we're going to repair it and that. But the Stanley Cup tour will go on.
Indeed it will. So that tour made it to Denver, Colorado today, with the championship parade set for this Thursday. Okay, from hockey sticks to rowing oars.
It's not really about us. You know, we're getting up in age, but it's really about the young crews that are coming through.
Next, we'll show you the women rowers who've just broken a big competitive barrier. It is a historic first and a major milestone for women rowers at the Royal St. John's Regatta, one of the oldest sporting events in North American history. Until now, women have rowed the short course, just over 1,200 meters long, which is half the distance the men row. But for the first time ever, women's teams got to compete on that long course. And this breaking of barriers is tonight's moment.
It was pretty emotional. I think there was a few tears for us all. It was a great morning. This has been about 20 years in the making. A number of female crews and a number of female advocates before this had wanted to row the long course. It was absolutely amazing. As we were passing through the ladies' kegs, our coxswain called for let's make history, and then we pushed right through those kegs and went right to the bottom of the pond. It's not really about us. You know, we're getting up in age, but it's really about the young crews that are coming through. They're going to be the future of the regatta.
It's just really exciting. I remember hearing about the first women's crew to ever row, and I just thought that was so cool. So I'm so happy to be part of the first crew to do the full course. No, it was easier than I thought. Actually, I thought it was going to be really hard, but it was not bad. I actually liked it more than the shorter course, yeah.
Oh, it seems like pure excitement. The two teams just then were taking pictures together, making history together. It's fantastic.
Well, of course, that's just so cool for a few different reasons. But interesting to know, I guess the way they've done it is they don't even divide those races, the long course and the short course, by gender anymore. Any team is able to row whichever distance they want. So that includes the men's team being able to race the shorter races because some people think those are the more exciting ones. But hey, after 200 plus years of being an event, always something new to happen. That's the National for this June 27th. Have a great night.